and she's an advocate for me. Her friendship is about seeking how God wants to work in my life.
That's just something that I would hear or something they would say to please me or to have life a better.
What I'm most thankful and most grateful for is that she has always sought to guide me back to God. And if you would like more information about spiritual friends, please go to brentwoodbaptist.com/journey.
Is an insert that talks about these ministries. It talks about John Thomas, who's going to come and preach for us and to us in just a moment. On the very back, it lists some mission journey opportunities. And you'll notice it says here, list is not exhaustive. It might look exhausting because of all the places that we go. Over 500 of our members were sent around the world down the road to Rainsville, Alabama, places like Chicago last year. We are to be a going and a sending church. A team just returned from South Africa to work with our Living Hope partners. And on that team was someone, a young man who had been going to Kairos, who had not yet made a decision for Christ. Guess where he made that decision for Christ? It was on that mission journey, and he was baptized. Our ushers are going to come forward in just a moment. In Hudson Hall, there are the blue buckets on your table or the blue buckets at the end of the row. We have much to be grateful for. So maybe as we pray in just a moment, you pick out one of these or several of these. Is it Grace Works? Is it Welcome Home? Is it Hope Clinic? Is it African Leadership? Is it the Tennessee Baptist Children's Home? Is it our missionaries? Is it the National Rescue Mission? Where would God lead you in just this moment to bless one of our partners? I hope that Brentwood Baptist is known as being a hospitable and caring church. Would you do one more favor for me after the worship service? Will you go to these and will you tell them thank you? Maybe you think that your dance card is full and you cannot handle and you cannot squeeze in one more thing to do. Well, you've not listened to the sermon yet, so that could change. But even if you don't volunteer, could you just go and say thank you? And we are glad that we partner with you. Let me challenge you to do that. So as our ushers come forward to prepare for today's offering, would you honor our missionaries? Would you honor our partners? And would you please stand as we pray? know, some people, the more you get to know them, the less you like them. In the 10 years that I've known John, the more I get to know him, the more I love him. So, we are blessed. As God willing, we are a blessing to Living Hope and to all of our partners here. Let us pray together. Our dear and gracious Heavenly Father, you are generous. May you find us to be made in your image. And may you take these gifts and multiply them greatly. As we reach out to those across the ocean, as we reach out to those who are across the sea, as we reach out to those who are across our state, as we reach out to those who are across the street, or in our very homes, will you find us a radically normal people who are completely and utterly committed to your name and your renown. And we pray all of this in your name.
It is so good to be home with you at Brentwood Baptist. I want you to know that besides the home church in Cape Town that I'm privileged to pastor, King of Kings, there is no other church in the world that I attend more often than this church. So this is my second home church, and I want to thank Pastor Mike Glenn for the opportunity of preaching, and thank you for your wonderful, exceptional, generous love and support that you give to us, we hope, for the world offering and through sending partners and missionaries. 16 of your members are serving with us right now today in Cape Town. So, Brentwood Baptist Church, on behalf of King of Kings and Living Hope, thank you. You know, the A-team, I used to like it. I was a bit younger in those days, but I always used to say, I love it when a plan comes together. Well, I am stunned at the opportunity that God has given me today in preaching the Word, because somehow it's just my heart. And it's exactly the next passage that you are going to be dealing with in your series. In any case, no worries is the title this morning. Now, worry and the effects of worry must be the biggest multi-million dollar business in this world. I mean, if you're planning to get rich, then find something linked to worry and the antidote for it, and you will be a millionaire. End of story. I mean, if you're worried about the future, you can get life insurance, home insurance. I mean, you can do anything. You can insure your dog. You can get a better security system in your home. I mean, if you're worried about your health, you can get vitamins. You can even buy specially formulated green gunk, which will guarantee to make you thin if you're worried that you're too fat. I mean, worry, you can make big money out of it, no matter which way you look at it. If you're worried about the look on your face getting a bit older, get some Botox, and you sort it. I mean, look as young as ever you want to, but then you will be worried about the bill that you pay a cosmetic surgeon to do the Botox. This morning, in this passage of Scripture, Jesus offers the real fix for worry. The trouble is, most of us don't want to do what Jesus says is the guaranteed fix for worry. And so, as we look at the series on how Jesus taught us to live, I want you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6 and verse 25. Matthew 6 and verse 25, as we read this passage of Scripture together. This is why I tell you, don't worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the sky. cubit to his height.
I worry. I love Holman's version here. Because if this was actually true, we'd all be giants. If you could get taller by worrying, I wonder how big some of you would be, or how tall some of you would be. And what do you worry about? Clothes. Learn about the wild flowers of the field. They don't labor or spin thread. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon, in all his splendor, was adorned like one of these. If that's how God clothed the grass of the field, which is here today, thrown into the furnace tomorrow, won't he do much more for you? You have little faith. So, don't worry saying, what will we eat, or what will we wear, or what will we drink? For the idolaters eagerly seek all these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But, that's about seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This passage of scripture is so counter-culture. It's so different to what we're taught how to live. It's completely opposite to the way we think. And I want to tell you, it's the same in Brentwood. The issue of worry is the same in Brentwood as it is in the poverty-stricken suburbs of Cape Town. We spend so much time and energy on worrying how to get stuff, and then once we get it, how to get more, because we believe a lie that was inbred in the human nature in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve believed they just needed one more thing, then they'll be happy. And they worried about getting it one more thing. But Jesus comes and he says to you today, stop worrying about things. My child, stop worrying about getting stuff. It's very interesting that Jesus doesn't say, if you happen to worry, then, he knows it with worry. He says, stop worrying. Don't worry. You remember that song, and I can't sing to save my life, but I'm not going to do it too much. Do you remember that song about 20 years ago? Don't worry, be happy. Well, here's the God version of it. Don't worry, be kingdom seekers. That's what God says. I mean, seriously, that's what it's about. And as a good Baptist this morning, I've got 3 points. The first one is the longest, so don't worry. And the first one is Jesus' pronouncements. What Jesus had to say. His commands, if you like. In the Greek here, the words seek first his kingdom are in imperative form. It's a command. There's no option. As Christians, you have to obey. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things, all the stuff you worry about, will be provided. Now, you know, the thing that worries me about you're getting it. You're more awake than the previous services. Maybe it's 8 o'clock or it's too early in the morning for the brain to go. But this verse becomes just like spiritual jargon. I mean, if you've been a Christian a while, coming to a good church like this, you can quote this verse backwards. But you don't do it. It's just like jargon, you know. Seek first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added to you, provided for you. And most of us have put it the other way around. Worry first. has been able to fix it, even sort of thousands of bucks of tablets haven't been able to fix it, then revert to God last and maybe he can help. We've got it all the wrong way around. And Jesus says in his pronouncement, says the first one, don't worry. Don't worry. Matthew 6:35. This is what I tell you. This is why I tell you. Don't worry about your life or what you will eat or what you will drink or about your body, what you will wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothing? Verse 31 is much the same. So don't worry saying, what will we eat or what will we drink or what will we wear? Or I think if Jesus had been here today, he would have added, or what car you will drive or where we will live or what second home we need to have. Don't worry is a command. But listen very carefully. This command is irrevocably connected. It's married, if you like. It can't get a divorce from seek first the kingdom of God. These two things are intermixed. Don't worry. Be kingdom seekers. The one belongs to the other. And so listen, getting to a position of not worrying is for those who have learned to seek first God's kingdom. I'm going to say that again. Getting to a position in your life of not worrying is for those who have learned to seek God's kingdom first and God's right way of living. You say to me, John, are you serious? Are you really serious? Does God actually expect me not to worry? You know, I'm a worry factory. If I could sell worry, I would be a millionaire. Somebody has said worry is the interest you pay on tomorrow's troubles. But I want to tell you, as Abel and I have sought in our own lives, simply and not always got it right, put God first. He's taken unbelievable care of us. We have been amazed by the continued faithfulness of God. Don't worry. But Jesus goes on and he says in these pronouncements, be different to the rest of the world. Look at verse 32, be different to the rest of the world. For the idolaters eagerly seek all these things, the stuff, and your heavenly Father knows you need them. Now, what's idolatry? Well, idolatry, very simply, is anything that is in first place in your life above God. So whatever is more important to you, be it a partner, your job, your money, your whatever is of first importance to you, if it's above God, if it's not God, let me rather say, it's not. This morning as I woke up, the very first thing that was on my mind was this sinner. And it was almost as if God said to me, you know what? Here's the acid test of what you seek first. What do you wake up thinking about? What do you wake up thinking about? Is it what I've got to do today? Is it how am I going to get this sorted? Or is it that guy? Or is it that girl? Or is it sex? Or is it God? Because that's one of the tests to determine what comes first. You know, in some ways, I'm really glad I don't live in Brentwood. Because I could so easily get caught up in the Brentwood rat race. I would be the lead rat. Well, I'd love to be the lead rat. I could be the top rat. This place is awesome. It's got every single shop you need. It's got everything you can dream of. like sort of heaven in Brentwood, you know. I mean, it's unbelievable. But I wonder if the rat race isn't how God sees a small little rat chasing stuff. Chasing it, bringing it to something. And God says, that's idolatry. That's putting stuff in front of me. And if you're going to worry about more houses and more four-wheelers and more, then God says, you're an idolater. I'm glad I didn't say it. I mean, you heard it from me. God says, you see, because for a visiting pastor to come to a church that has been generous beyond our wildest imagination, come and talk about, like, this is idolatry in your life, is how not to win friends and influence people. I mean, what's this guy from South Africa coming to tell us about? But you see, that's God's word. And he says to you today, if you idolaters eagerly seek, value system about money to the world around us. You see, listen, if money could fix worry, then let me ask the question, how much money would it take to end your worry? I spoke a little while ago to a guy who had made a lot of money, and he said to me, you know, I spent the first half of my life worrying about making money, and now I'm spending the second half of my life worrying about how to keep the money because of the recession and because of everything else, my money's going. Well, I want to tell you today about a guaranteed investing fund that you may not have heard of that is an absolute sure investment that never, ever fails, and the returns are phenomenal. You know what it's called? The Kingdom of God Investment Fund. Seek that first, and you will be stunned at the returns. The worries are gone, and the joy is come as you see the harvest coming. Be different to the rest of this world. Become a devoted kingdom seeker. Become a devoted kingdom seeker. Get this. Don't worry, certain perspective. Jesus isn't us. This is not just saying, okay, don't worry, everything's cool, it'll all work out fine. No, no, this is Mary. Don't worry. Start seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's the command of God. Then and then only will all these other things be provided. God says, do my work, give to my work, and then you'll see me come through, says the Lord. God's pronouncements. Jesus' pronouncements to you today. Don't worry. Be different to the rest of this world and be a kingdom devoted seeker. But secondly, the priorities. Jesus' priorities. We've already done this verse a few times, but Matthew 6:33, let's read it again. But seek first the kingdom of God in his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. It's about priorities. What comes first? Remember I said to you, what did you wake up with this morning? What was your first thought? One of the most biggest issues we struggle with as Christians is that while we say in theory God is first in our lives, in reality, But see, first this kingdom, not second, this kingdom, or third this kingdom. And this is something you don't even need to pray about. You don't even need to debate and say, well, Lord, you know, I really wish you'd give me a sign as to whether I need to seek first the kingdom. It's a command, folks. It's do it. And what part of that didn't you understand? Seek first the kingdom of God. Jesus said, John, are you serious? God would be first order in my life. I've got a family, don't you understand? I've got a mortgage. I've got a student loan. Don't you understand? What I understand is what God says. And He says, seek first my kingdom and living right, His righteousness, and then I'll take care of the rest. I don't know how you'll do it, but I know you'll do it. So you might say to me, well, you know, when just unpack this kingdom thing. What is the kingdom of God? What does this look like? Well, Jesus summed up the kingdom of God very nicely for us in Matthew 22:37-40. He said to him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the most important. This is the number one. This is the first command. The second is like love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets depend on these two commandments. Okay, you want to know in four words what the kingdom of God is? Together, love God, love people. That's it. The kingdom of God is all about loving God first, loving people. You get that? You got what the kingdom of God is all about. And so how do you seek that in reality? How do you seek God's kingdom first? Well, by loving people in mission and evangelism. By going and telling your neighbor about Jesus. And by going to the other side of the world. Listen to Act 1:8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Brentwood, in Tennessee, and to the ends of the earth. That's the John version of it, but it's actually what it means. My friend, there is the going part. And you know what we do in church? We say, come to our churches. It's really cool. And by the way, it is. But I mean, you know, come to Kairos, come to BBC. Jesus says, go to the world. You go tell them at the other end of the world. Now, not everybody's called to go. But to get them going, some of you are called to give. And to give sacrificially and generously. Most amazing hope for the world offering. It's got the amazing support system for missionaries. How could there be 16 missionaries in Cape Town from this church if there weren't a bunch of you staying and giving? But some of you can give far more, and you know you can. But we wrestle with this money stuff. We want to hold it. And we don't want to release it out of our fist. But you love mission and evangelism, and go visit these stalls in the alleyways, in the hallways, and see whether God hasn't got a place for you in them. But also, we seek first the kingdom of God by loving people in need. By loving people in need. One of my favorite scriptures is Isaiah. I know it's funny. Isaiah 58:67. Isn't this the path I choose? To break the chains of wickedness, to untie the ropes of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, to tear off every yoke. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, to bring the poor and the homeless into your house, to clothe the naked, and when you see them, not to ignore son to be true bred Baptist. My son is now seventh generation Baptist pastor. Now beat that. Beat that. And thank you for supporting Victor and Hans to Hope for the World offering as well, for the students to go there. But I was brought up Baptist, school Baptist, and was by Baptist. I mean, that's us. But nobody ever taught me that Jesus was interested in anything more than people's souls. I thought, get a soul saved and you're done. But Jesus wants compassionate action to be shown to people. To love people in their need. To break the yoke of oppression. You want to know what the biggest yoke of oppression is? It's poverty. Wherever you've got poverty, you've got oppression and you've got injustice. And the best way to break the yoke, Brentwood Baptist Church, of poverty is by giving people the dignity of earning their way out of poverty. And that's exactly what Joey Lamp has come to. To come and help people find this yoke of poverty broken over their lives by earning their way out of farming. And so God takes a little country Tennessee boy who knows something about medical stuff and he makes him into a farmer. How's that for God? And Joey's come down, and that's exactly what he's doing. And you know what Living Hope has just done? We've just bought a farm all around our buildings. And we've been cash. Thank you for giving to Hope for the World. Because you, yes, you helped us get that. And now we just going to put a whole bunch of funnels, get that all figured out from there, and a whole lot more people will help have this yoke of poverty broken over their lives. But not only do we love the kingdom of God, is loving people in mission and evangelism and in need, it's also by loving broken. I want to tell you some of these homeless folks, some of these missions that we're representing. Loving broken people is hard, guys. They bite you back. They nail you while you're helping. But Jesus, Isaiah 61, verse 1, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because He has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to heal the broken. To proclaim liberty for captives and freedom for prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And another one of Brentwood Baptist members, David Kerr, has come down to Cape Town and shot a video or shot a movie called Living Hope, the documentary. And I want to tell you, when it hits the screens, you are going to cry big time. It is powerful. And tomorrow night, if you come and sign up, there's some details of how you can sign up. Tomorrow night on this, you will see another 15 more minutes of this. But watch this clip now about a broken person.
Some years ago, I happened to sport to the local hospital, to the maternity. Go and see a 14-year-old young girl who had just given birth. The nurse had called her and said, "This young girl is very depressed. Please come and see her." And in our country, the baby is next to my landlord's crib. And they put the name of the baby above the crib. And as our chaplain walked into this maternity ward and saw the mother and the crib, she saw the name of the baby. And we could be dead. Which means no hope. Now, can you imagine calling your child no hope? No hope! disciple would have said, who named this child? I mean, you know, don't give a child a name like this. And this little 14-year-old girl sort of lifted her head out from under the sheets and she said, why on earth would you name the child a name? So we see it like this. My mother died with HIV and AIDS. I moved into my auntie. She died with AIDS. So I moved into some kind neighbors that I didn't really know. And they had a 16-year-old son. And he said to me, girl, you got to pay to stay here. And the way you pay to stay here is by giving me sex. But soon, she said, I found that's great. When I told him, he said, go get out of this house. He brought HIV into this house. Me and my wife. And so a very kind neighbor, not a good one, to the man. But she lived in one room, which had a double bed in it. And she was a single mom with two children. And so she said to me, you can stay here until your baby is born. But then five of us can't share that bed. He said, you need to go to somewhere else when you're ready to go. She said, yesterday I came into this hospital. I gave birth to my baby. And in an extremely rare condition, the baby came out of the womb in an advanced stage of AIDS. So she said, can I know where to go tomorrow when they discharge me? I've got AIDS. And now my baby's got AIDS. Do you know why I don't want to let you know that? That's why. When I was talking about all of me, a few minutes later after she left the hospital, got up to the phone, found a place for her to stay in the church because we were at words. This is like I did an opportunity to see somebody. And sent me in Tamika in one of our workshops producing jewelry. Susie had the dignity of earning income and being able to rent her own little shanty. 2 minutes later, I walked into the room and called me and said, Tamika called me. She said, what's the job here? She said, yes, Tamika, she has something to do. Tamika said, you people have shown me Jesus. I think I'll find him. So that he is mine. A few months later, she walked back into the center and she said, well, some of these statements are part of her defense. But I'm in the face of where we register the words and the pages and things. And I said to her, why do you want to go to her defense? She said, I want to change my baby's name. I said, you want to go to bed? I want to change my baby's name to Loretta, which means the Lord is my hope. You see, that story gets this stuff to the end of the garden. We seek to take people who have no and introduce them to Jesus so that they become people of dignity and self-worth. So they can see the Lord.
Building God's kingdom to people who are broken so that they can see the Lord is my hope. If you put God's kingdom first, then finally Jesus is his promise, not mine. Here it is. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things might be provided. All these things, say it with me, will be provided.
Now, why don't you believe it? Why do you put God's kingdom second? As we bow in prayer, I want you to reflect over that question. Am I genuine seeking God's kingdom first, or is stuff and money and success and power and prestige and getting more got in the way? And if you prepare to say, Lord, today I hear your